All right, folks, welcome back. It is time for our next 6.5 Creedmoor video. And today we're gonna be shooting some more of these guys. This is the 135 grain Berger Classic Hunter. I ordered a couple more boxes of these guys because the performance has been incredible. Here in 6.5 Creedmoor, the last video we shot it with Reloder 17 and IMR 4350. We didn't shoot any groups over an inch. So we're seeing very consistent, excellent groups with this bullet. It's shooting even better over in 6.5 Grendel. In those videos with this bullet, it's been incredible. So they're expensive, but I thought it was worth picking up a couple more boxes because I want to explore these guys a little bit more. Now, our velocities in the last video with 6.5 Creedmoor were pretty mild. Reloader 17, we took it to 2,700 feet per second. IMR 4350, we barely took it past 2,600 feet per second. But we didn't really have any good load data to work from. So we were trying to keep things conservative. Now, Berger has got load data for this bullet in 6.5 Creedmoor on their website. And that was the main problem, is I just really didn't have the powders that they listed. But since then, I've picked up some Reloader 26. This is a curious little powder. You'll see that for one thing, just the number, Reloader 26, makes you think of really big cartridges, big Magnum stuff, and you wouldn't just pick up a can of Reloader 26 thinking, wow, I wonder if this is good in 6.5 Creedmoor. It just seems like it's going to be too slow, too bulky for the case, for the case size of 6.5 Creedmoor. That is, until you look over at that Berger load data. They have load data for Reloader 26 with this 135 grain bullet. And the velocities are silly. They use, I think, a 24-inch test barrel. We're shooting a 22-inch barrel. But their numbers from a 24-inch barrel are 2977 feet per second using Reloader 26 and this bullet. That is really quick, very fast. So that's what I want to do today. I want to shoot some of these guys with Reloader 26 and see what sort of velocities we get with our little Thompson center compass. The compass has been shooting very, very well. So I'm hoping we'll get the same thing here. We've got a bullet that we already know is a good shooter. It's a great candidate for a hunting bullet. And we've got a powder that can give us some insane velocities, but still, stay within published load data. So it seems like the perfect combo, man. Now this video is a bit of a half-ass. I gotta be honest with y'all. Tomorrow's Christmas Eve, the day after is Christmas, and I want to have a video for each of those days. Those of you who would like to ignore your family, those of you who would rather not think about Christmas, you'd rather think about reloading, I want to fulfill your needs. So I'm trying to shoot two videos today. The problem with that is it's raining outside. It's going to stop right about 2 o'clock. So I'm going to have from 2 o'clock until 5 o'clock. That's my daylight window to shoot. I'm going to do a 223 video and I'm going to do this 6.5 Creedmoor video. That is not quite enough time. So I need to trim it down. Somebody needs to get the short end of the stick and it's going to be 6.5 Creedmoor. So we're only going to shoot 25 shots today instead of my normal 50. Actually, I guess the last 6.5 Creedmoor video, we only shot 35 shots. Man, I'm slacking on the Creedmoor stuff here, but you know what? It's kind of good, right? We've got a thin profile barrel. Trying to rush it, getting the barrel smoking hot, isn't going to do any of us any good. So, reducing round count in the Creedmoor videos with our Thompson Center Compass might just be a good, standard practice. But yeah, whatever. So today it's going to be 25 shots. Like I said, Berger's got their load data. They show a max charge of 49.8 grains. That is a ton of powder. Now, Berger actually shows the approximate fill ratio, like the case fill, and they show it as being 105%. So we're definitely going to be compressed at the top end, and I think we might actually be very compressed, but we'll see how it goes. Hopefully the bullets will seat okay, and we won't run into any of the problems that you sometimes run into with super heavily compressed charges. We'll talk about that more once we get to bullet seating. But here's the load data. We are continuing to shoot out of our same batch of 100 pieces of Starline small primer brass. This is the third firing on this stuff. It has been tumbled here after the last firing. So this has already been resized and chamfered and all of that stuff. It's really ready for primer powder and bullets. This batch of brass has not needed trimmed yet. Still kind of short. That seems to be a thing with the Starline brass. It comes a little short, which is kind of good and kind of bad. There's a lot of comfort in taking your batch of brass and trimming it all to the exact same length and feeling like you've got an extremely consistent length. But then again, it's nice being able to fire brass 3 or 4 times before you need to worry about trimming. And it's been shooting well for us, right? We've been shooting good groups. We're going to continue to use the same primer we have been using, the CCI 450 Small Rifle Magnum Primer. We're going to stick with the same overall length of 2.800 inches. Kind of the, you know, the standard length. Not getting cute here with the overall length quite yet. We're going to start playing around with that sooner rather than later. We'll find a bullet, a nice conservative load that we like, and play around with our overall length and our distance to the lands. Maybe not with this bullet, but then again, maybe with this bullet. I don't know. That's coming soon, but at least for right now, I want to stick with 2.8 inches. That's, you know, that's magazine length in pretty much any gun out there. And that's what Berger calls the their, you know, starting overall length or their standard overall length. So that's what we'll go with. The max charge is 49.8 grains, like I said. And I want to shoot all the way up to the maximum because I think in this case, pressure's not going to be a problem just because we can't get enough of this powder into the case to blow our face off. At least I don't think so. So I want to cover a lot of range. So let's shoot half grain increments. Not really necessarily the smartest thing to do when you're shooting something all the way up to max. But like I said, this powder's so darn slow. Hopefully we won't get ourselves into trouble. So that's going to take us down to 47.8. So we're going to shoot from 47.8 up to 49.8. They show the starting load as being 45.0. So we're kind of cheating. We're starting like right about the middle of their range. So I don't know. I don't know how it'll go. We'll see. So I think that's it. We've talked about everything, right? Yep. All right. I'm going to get to priming. And this loading should go pretty quick. All right, so as expected, the case fill on these guys is pretty crazy. Our lowest charge, 47.8 grains, isn't bad at all. And just to give you an idea about seating depth, with the Berger Classic Hunter, the bottom of the bearing surface of the bullet is right at the bottom of the neck. So basically the whole boat tail portion is down below the base of the neck and extends just about to the bottom of the shoulder. So even our lightest charge here, definitely going to, you know, be a little bit compressed. Now our top charge of 49.8 grains, up into that neck a little bit. Now these, I am doing everything I can to settle these a lot. Give them a little tappy, tap, tap, tap. A lot of tapping, honestly, the best way I've found is, you know, with your funnel. And then I dump my charge is just continuously tapping it for like 10 seconds. Seems to really be the most effective at settling. So, I mean, you'll see 15 people down in the comments talking about how I should use toothbrushes or sex toys or something to vibrate the powder lower. And, you know, that's good stuff. Like that can work. That can definitely work. I've never tried it, but I've seen other people do it. I just don't normally shoot, you know, charges that are this compressed. So it's just not something I've really, you know, worried too much about or explored a lot. But I feel like I've got these reasonably well settled. And I'll tell you what, let me weigh out the next charge here and I'll show you what it looks like before it's settled. I'll tell you another thing I should really mention to you guys, because you see me do this a lot. I weigh out a bunch of charges and then I go over and I seat the bullets. This is really not the best way to do things. I mainly do it because I've got to readjust my camera position and it's more about filming. If I didn't have a camera on, I would weigh one charge and seat that bullet, put it in my ammo case and move on to the next one. Or I might do a row of five and then seat those five bullets and then move on to the next one. Weighing out 25 charges like this is just inviting a spill or a confusion, you know, accident. Especially where you're working with a completely full loading tray, you can easily flip it 180 degrees and lose track of what's going on. So just kind of wanted to mention that. So I'll tell you what, let's dump this powder charge three different ways. The first way, let's call it the brute force method. Just dump it in there and let it trickle down. So that is by far the worst way. For one way, or you know, for one thing, there's no settling at all. Powder charge is all the way up to the neck, to the top of the neck. And the other problem, we didn't see it there, but you can get what's called powder bridging, which I'll tell you what, let me see if I can get this guy to bridge. Nope, it's not going to bridge on me. But bridging means that it gets, you know, clogged up. You basically clog up your funnel and the powder stops flowing. So that was the worst way. I never dump charges that way. The way I normally do it is to pour the charge down the side of the funnel and let it flow in. And you can see the difference between that charge and the last one. You know, that gave us quite a bit more settling. We're actually almost there. And then what I generally do, like I mentioned, after I've slowly poured that in, then I just start tapping and do this for like 10 seconds. And there it is. That's what I would consider a settled charge. Another option is to use a funnel with a long drop tube. This is out of a little cheap little MTM universal funnel kit. There's one made by Forster, I believe it was. Mopar Madman over on his channel did a review of it. It looked pretty cool, and he found that it worked really well. But I think the biggest thing with this, my last pour, I poured slowly. I think this is kind of, there's some bridging. There you go. See, this funnel with these universal attachments is bad about bridging. And that's what'll, you know, sometimes get you into trouble with a case-activated powder measure on your press, or, you know, powder measures in general. They sometimes do this crap. So a few taps. Get that going. But I found, at least with this cheap little MTM long drop, I'm not getting any additional settling than I do with my normal slow pour and tap method. And actually that guy needs a few more taps. So all right, I think that's enough talk about case fill. Let me weigh out these last two charges and then we'll start seating some bullets. So I went to just set the bullets on top of the cartridges, and our top charge, the bearing surface doesn't even reach the case mouth before the bullet's just basically sitting on powder. This is going to be an interesting little seating session here. Now, in a situation like this, it is absolutely critical that we use the right seating stem. So we've got our three seating stems for our Hornady die, and it's looking like this guy is providing the best fit. We want the most contact between ogive and seating stem that we can get, right, to spread out all of this crazy force we're about to put on the bullet to compress this powder. So, yep, there's our best seating stem. Now, if you take the worst fitting seating stem in the box, this guy, where bullet's all rocking around and the fit is not good at all, and try to do heavily compressed loads, you're going to end up with a ring around your bullets where the seating stem made contact and put all of that pressure. So this nice fitting stem should give us the best opportunity to not screw up our bullets. Now, from the last video, I forgot to write down the measurement of cartridge-based ogive with the Hornady bullet comparator. So these first five, I want to seat them and get, you know, we'll get to an average overall length of 2.8 inches. And then after that, we'll switch to the comparator. And we'll need to monitor our overall length as we get more and more compressed, because that overall length is going to grow a bit on us. I can tell you that already. All right, the first five are done. I'm seeing a range of 2.799 up to 2.803 or 4, I believe it was. Yeah, there's 2.803. As far as overall length, that's where we want to be. So now let's take a measurement and see what the cartridge-based ogive measurement is with the number 26 insert. 2.913. It's a long 2.913. I'm seeing 2.914 sometimes as well. 2.914. 194. I've been saying 914 the whole time, haven't I? My brain gets weird sometimes. Yeah, 2.194. There's a 2.195 and a 2.193. So I'll tell you what I'm actually going to do. I've got my 2.194 here. I'm going to go ahead and zero my calipers. And then as we get more and more compressed, we'll be able to see whether it's growing. And I'll tell you what, before we spill anything, I'm going to skip ahead to the highest charge weight. So this guy's going to be compressing right from the start. It didn't feel too bad. It didn't even sound all that crunchy. See how much it grew? Not that much. Only 0.002". This guy's 0.003". So this isn't really all that bad. 0.003". Good. And a lot of people, when they're doing compressed charges, sometimes they'll run it back through one more time just for the heck of it. 0.02". 0.02". Yeah, maybe it did help just a touch. So I'll tell you what, I'm not going to worry about screwing with my seating die. If you're, you know, if you're right up there at your magazine length, you might need to chase your seating die a little bit as you get higher in charges. But I'm not going to worry about it for 0.002". I'm absolutely not going to worry about it. I'll tell you what, let's see if we can get an up close look at this bullet. All right, here are the three that I've seated so far at the highest charge. There you go. You see those little rings on the ogive of the bullet? That's where the seating stem contacted the bullet. Now, it's not bad at all. I'm not worried about it. I don't think we, you know, truly distorted the bullet in any meaningful way. But that's what you're watching out for. Is that getting worse? And eventually it'll make little rings in your bullet and screw your life up. All right, so I think we've wasted enough time in here gabbing about compressed loads. So let's go ahead and get out to the range. The very soggy, very wet range. All right, so this stupid rain is just not going to stop, but we're going to go ahead and shoot anyway. I've got my cameras covered with plastic bags, so we'll just see how this goes. We're shooting at 100 yards. The dots we're shooting at are 1 inch in diameter. This is a Thompson center compass, has a 22-inch barrel with a 1/8 twist. Our first load here with Reloader 26 is 47.8 grains. So let's get started. All right, we're already at 2,770 feet per second. The brass looks perfect. No problems to speak of. All right, average 2781, pretty darn good group to start out with. Brass looking awesome, fantastic. Okay, next up, 48.3 grains. All right, so that horizontal stringing isn't exactly what you want to see, but the brass looked good. I tell you what, I'm keeping an eye on the brass. I'll let you know if anything comes up, but I don't expect that we'll have any pressure problems here today. Next up is 48.8 grains. All right, 2858 with a 6.9 feet per second standard deviation. Crazy fast. So the groups don't seem, at this point, don't seem quite as good as we saw in the last video with this bullet. So, you know, this high velocity might come with a trade-off. Barrel getting a bit warm, so I'm gonna give it a few minutes to cool down here before the last couple shots. I've been giving it a minute or two between each group. I haven't been shooting crazy fast, but I haven't taken an extended break yet, so I think I'll do that now. Okay, a little bit of cool down time, and we're ready to keep going. Next up is 49.3 grains. All right, no pressure. No pressure. Eh, a little bit out. That's okay. They're all in there, right? I didn't bring out my spotting scope today, but definitely our best group. $28.99. Freaking hauling butt, man. All right, no pressure sign so far. So last up is 49.8 grains. All right, that's an interesting little target down there. 29.47, crazy. Let's get back to the bench. All right, let's start out with a look at the brass. Actually, the last three rows here were our first three charges. Primer's looking nice and round. Nothing really to see here. Of course, we've got here's our lowest charge. And we do see a little bit of the cratered look around the primer, like we've gotten used to with this gun, but no problems to see. Let me grab a couple from our top row. These were the hottest charges today. And I did notice a couple round, there we go, very top on this piece. Just a little round mark where the ejector was, but nothing shiny like we saw in the last video, which seemed to be our real indication that we were getting crazy. Yeah, I guess this one here on the left does have a little bit of shine to it. Let me look at that a little closer with my eyeballs instead of the camera viewfinder. Yeah, it does have a little bit of a shiny spot. Nothing I'm too worried about. Everything else seemed okay, and I'll tell you right now, I don't think we're going to be shooting this top charge anymore. This was a little bit too compressed for my liking, just for difficulty of loading reasons. So let's look at the next row down. Yep, here are a couple from the charge right below that. A little bit of shine to that guy as well. Primer's still looking good, nice and round. So I think we're in good shape. So let's have a look at the groups here. We kind of had three average ones, one good one, and one bad one. That second group really had that one shot that went way out to the right, and that made it a 1.904 inch group. Not good. And then our fourth group at 49.3, was our best by far at 0.749 inches. And then the other three were almost the same as far as group size, 1.072, 1.106, and 1.107. So this is a touch disappointing, right? Because our last video with this bullet, we shot Reloader 17, we shot IMAR 4350, and we didn't have any groups over an inch. So for pure accuracy across the board, you know, Reloader 26 just didn't really get it done as well. But we did have that one group, you know, 49.3 grains, and that might be a good region to explore more with this powder. Because, well, it's all a trade-off, right? So the last video with this bullet, our fastest velocity with Reloader 17 was 27.06. So our lowest charge in this video was 75 feet per second faster than our fastest in the last. And our highest velocity here, 29.47, is 250 feet per second. That is a lot. That is a ton of velocity. So it is definitely worth exploring that 49.3 grain range where we shot that one good group. Maybe it was a fluke, but I kind of like that region anyway, because like I said, 49.8 grains, our top charge, that was so much powder, it makes it very hard to load. Like I showed you earlier, we couldn't even set the bullets down in the case without the boat tail hitting the powder before the bullet reached the mouth, you know, before the bearing surface reached the mouth of the case. It is super annoying to load those sorts of things. You're always worried about spilling powder everywhere, but backing it down just that half grain to 49.3 makes life a whole lot easier. So maybe in the next video with this bullet, we'll explore, you know, maybe 49.5 down to, you know, maybe back down to 48.8, that region again, and see if we can duplicate that good group with 49.3 again. Because 2,900 feet per second is just awesome. Now that was our worst standard deviation of the day at 14.3. So we'll have to keep an eye on that, see if it's a trend, or if that was also just kind of a fluke. Another thing we could do, you know, this might be a good opportunity to start playing with overall length. Maybe we take that 49.3 grain charge that just shot a nice group for us and stretch out the overall length a little bit. This Thompson Center Compass, we've got a ridiculously huge magazine where we can stretch overall length a ton and still fit them in the magazine. So that might be the better way to go here. Just stick with that and play around with overall length. So the crazy amount of smoke that was coming out of the barrel, I don't know what to think about that. The temperature was barely above freezing, and it was one of those, you know, it had been raining all day long. It was one of those times out there where every breath you take is just a cloud. So I don't know whether that was just, you know, the environmental conditions were causing that, or if we're just blowing a whole bunch of unburned powder out the barrel and that like crazy amount of smoke and crap is a characteristic of this powder. So that's something else to keep an eye on. I don't think it would really matter to me, to be honest with you. I don't mind a smoky powder. I know some people might, but I'm thinking it was just the weather. But we'll keep an eye on it in the next video, definitely. So I think that's pretty much it. Man, my plans have gone to crap. Like I had mentioned earlier when we hit the range, I had my cameras covered up with plastic bags trying to keep them dry. The forecast said it was supposed to stop raining at 2:30, and it didn't stop until a little after 3:30. So by the time I finished these rounds, it was almost dark. So I wasn't able to shoot the 223 rounds for tomorrow's video. So I don't know if I'm going to be able to get it. I don't know if I'm going to be able to get it done or not, because my only hope is to wake up early, get out on the range, and shoot as early as I possibly can where I don't think the neighbors will come and shoot me, because I've got family stuff in the afternoon. So I need like 2 hours on the range. I've got 3 hours of driving, 4, 5, 6 hours with the family, and then an additional 3 hours or so to get that video put together to upload tomorrow night for a Christmas morning release. I don't know. That's a lot of hours to cram into that day. So I'm going to give it a shot, but no promises on tomorrow's video, folks. It might just not happen. It just might not happen. You know, what can you do? I can't control the weather. Once we hit 1,000 supporters on Patreon, maybe I'll build an indoor range for myself so that I don't have to worry about the weather. And speaking of that, if you want to help support my channel, you can go to patreon.com/reloading. And I'll see you guys hopefully tomorrow, but maybe not.